This is Showtime Eric Young from Team Canada's TNA Wrestling. You're listening to In Your Head Online. And big crowds scare me, so hopefully not a lot of people watch this. I get nervous.
And now we're joined on the phone by a member of Team Canada, right from TNA. We have Bobby Roode. Welcome to In Your Head, Bobby.
Thanks for having me.
Cool. How are you doing this evening, sir?
Doing just fine.
Yep. We check out TNAWrestling.com. Because you got a big pay-per-view coming out at the end of the month. Bound for Glory. Have you been announced for a match on the show yet?
I believe what transpired on TV this past week, I think there's something brewing between Team Canada and Three Live Crew.
Oh, cool.
So I believe there might be a six-man tag in the works.
Yeah. That's just not going to be a normal pay-per-view. It's because the day before that, Saturday, October 22nd, you got the big fan festival.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. Are you looking forward to that?
Yeah, I am. We had our first one last year. I guess it was around the same time last year. It went real well, and looking forward to it again this year.
Yeah. I think it gives fans a chance to be interactive with the wrestlers and everybody.
That's right.
Because on the line it said there's already been 40 wrestlers announced that's going to be there.
Mm-hmm.
One of those 40 guys, you?
I will be there.
All right.
All Team Canada will be there.
Now, you said that, as you said, the first TNA impact on Spike TV went off without a hitch. I mean, what did you think personally of the show?
I thought it went real well. I mean, I heard about some of the reviews on the internet and whatnot. And some of the negative reviews were, I mean, I guess what people are forgetting is the fact that it's only 60 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And with commercials, it's only about a 45-minute program, so it's really hard to... have significantly long matches and tell great stories on TV. But I think for the first time, and I think I thought the show was great. I thought it told some stories and planted some seeds, and I thought it was real good.
Yeah. On our forums, pretty much everyone really enjoyed the show.
Which
was cool.
Good. I enjoyed it. I thought it was really good.
So one thing you noticed right away when it came on was the improved production values.
Definitely, yeah.
Gave the show a much better look.
Yeah, I think so too.
Yeah. And then, also that same weekend, the 23rd, is the pay-per-view when it's going to be live.
Right.
When you debuted in TNA, did you debut as part of Team Canada?
Yeah, I did, actually. Brought in last May, part of the X-Cup.
Right.
Myself and Showtime Eric Young were brought in to replace two guys. That was myself, Eric Young, John.
Mm-hmm.
We stayed together as a couple of the Unfest teams on the line. But A1's there to fill the gap, and he's doing a good job, so we're having a blast.
When they approached you about the Team Canada, was it going to be a long... Did you know it was going to be a long-term deal, or was it just going to be part of the Cup tournament?
Basically, at the time, I was brought in for the Cup only, and our first match, there was an eight-man tag, Team Canada against... It was Triple X, Chris Daniels, Felix Skipper, Saban, and Jerry Lynn. And we tore the house down that night. It was a really good match. And I guess turned some heads in the office. And the following week and the week after that, during the X-Cup, we had some great matches. And we kind of started to get a little bit of heat there from the Nashville crowd. And we were just about to go on to Fox. So the idea was to continue to have Team Canada together to go on to Fox and the rest of the country.
Yeah. Did you think the gimmick would get over so big? Because you see a lot of fans with the Team Canada shirts and stuff on.
Yeah, no, I never really thought it would get to where it's at right now. Within the company, we talked to some people and... No, there's not really too many groups nowadays in professional wrestling that can stay together and remain a heel group for as long as we have. And even that's almost a year and a half now that we've been together and going strong. Mm-hmm. So, we didn't expect it to go this long. We didn't expect it to even, surpass the X-Cup, to be honest. So,
right.
But we're going to keep doing what we're doing, and hopefully things will continue to go the way they are.
Yeah, they even opened a sub-site on TNAWrestling.com for Team Canada, I noticed today.
Yeah, it's been up since, I believe, maybe July or August.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's
pretty cool. One of the guys when you guys started with Team Canada was Teddy Hart. He's kind of a controversial guy on the internet. Did you get along with him okay?
To be honest, I was one of the guys that replaced Teddy.
Oh, okay.
In Showtime replaced Teddy and Jack Evans. So I've never actually met, I've never really met Teddy Hart. I've only heard stories, and so I can't really, I can't really speculate on him. So, you know, like I said, I've never met him, so.
Yeah. You think he'd be a good fit if he came back to TNA?
I don't know. I mean, I've never actually watched the guy work before, but I've never met him, so I don't know if he would fit or not. I mean, he was there once before, and he's not there now for whatever reason, so.
Right.
I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah.
Did you feel you got an opportunity to really step up and take center stage when Scott D'Amore was taken off television, as far as developing yourself in promos?
Yeah, I mean, that was basically a lot of the idea when Scott was injured off TV. That really gave us an opportunity to kind of get our characters over, and in the following weeks and months, our characters will continue to establish themselves, even with Scott back now in the picture. You know, we've all got a character to portray, and you know, we all have something different to give. I think that's why Team Canada is actually doing so well, because we're not all, you know, cut from the same cloth, so to speak.
Right.
We're all different sizes, and right. So I mean, it's definitely
just interchangeable members.
Yeah, I mean, and when it comes to you know, when Scott was gone off TV, it gave us an opportunity to actually speak on camera, and you know, I mean, I think it was shocking to some of the guys, you know, in the office to actually listen to our promos, because they never really had an opportunity to listen to us talk before. So, you know, it was a blessing in disguise, I guess.
Where did you wrestle before you came to TNA?
I did a lot. I've been in business now for almost 8 years. I did a lot of stuff for WWE. I did camps. I did a lot of dog matches and matches for them. And, I spent a little bit of time over in Puerto Rico, and I did a lot of independence and a lot of course, in Canada, mainly in Eastern Canada, in the Maritimes, Nova Scotia, and New Brunswick.
Is this your first shot to really do a lot of promos?
Yeah, yes and no. The where I worked in Eastern Canada, there was some TV that we shot at there, so at the time I did a little bit of promos for them, but when I did some of the WWE camps, we did promos every single day, so I was always very comfortable doing promos. So, but you know, right now TNA has been giving us, you know, every pay per view so far we've actually had a chance to talk. So, yeah. So basically,
yeah. Cool. Were you ever offered a WWE developmental deal?
The not officially. There was a lot of talk over the last before I came to TNA that I may have been offered something, but nothing ever was put on the table for me. So. So officially no, but I've heard there may have been something in the works.
Right. You should be happy now that you're still with TNA.
Things happen for a reason, so I'm really glad where I am right now, and I wouldn't change it, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Has the change in the way that TNA is booked these days, with Scott D'Amore on the booking committee and others, have you noticed the change in the way you're booked, and how have you reacted to that?
You know, not particularly. Before Scott and the rest of the committee were put together and put in charge, Dusty Rhodes I never have anything bad to say about Dusty. He was always a big fan of mine, and you know, gave me an opportunity to, you know, go work with Dustin in a cage match at Lockdown, and he gave me some other opportunities on TV as well. And actually, he was the first guy that actually let me talk on Impact. So, the Scott, I mean, there was probably, when Scott first came into charge with the other guys, there was probably a lot of rumors and talk going around how Team Canada is going to get a big push. But, I mean, it's not any different than it was before,
right?
To be honest with you. But everybody backstage is real upbeat and real happy with the way the creative team is controlling things right now.
Right. Do you like to pass Scott D'Amore back with Team Canada all the time on TV, or do you kind of like it this way it is?
You know, Scott, it's fun having Scott at ringside, actually. So, yeah, it's good that he's back now, and it should be interesting to see where we're going to go with all this.
Yeah.
Do you see him taking more of a step back to be a member of Team Canada instead of really the coach?
I think he'll remain a coach. I don't foresee Scott, you know, putting his boots back on at any time. I think he'll remain, you know, a manager coach type of thing.
Do you see yourself as more sticking with the singles for Team Canada?
Once I way back when, I mean, a year and a half ago, the whole idea was to have me singles in the heavyweight, Petey Williams in the X division, and Jerry right. Devine and Showtime as the tag team. With injuries and such, I found myself a lot doing tag team stuff, which was a blessing because I really love tag team wrestling, and I love tagging with Showtime. He's the best partner I've ever had, to be honest with you. I think he's great. And but now that, we started to kind of go back in that direction again with A1. He was going to be the tag guy with Showtime, and I was starting to do some single stuff. But now that we started on Spike, we're kind of reestablishing the whole Team Canada as a group right now and educating right. the new fans and stuff. So, I mean, eventually down the road, I think that's where we're going to go back to, me being in the singles spot. But time will tell. I hope so. I mean, I don't mind being honest with you. I mean, I love being in every part of the tags. I think our tag division is great, especially yeah. with the addition of 3D. So, but, I'm just happy doing what I'm doing right now, so we'll just have to wait and see.
Yeah, it's not really taking a step back in TNA because the tag team division's really established as a big deal there.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, and I mean, as far as the heavyweight division goes, it's getting better and better every day, I think, too. And I mean, people, I heard somewhere they were knocking the heavyweight division, but I mean, the whole emphasis right now is basically put on a lot on the X division because it differentiates us from the
right.
UFC in New York. So.
Yeah, but, I think the tag team division does, too.
Yeah, absolutely. I think our tag division is head and shoulders above theirs. And, I'm just happy doing what I'm doing, whether it's six-man tags or eight-man tags or singles or, whatever
yeah.
it is. It doesn't matter. I'm just happy doing what I'm
yeah.
doing right now.
Are you looking forward to getting in the ring with Team 3D?
When the time comes, yeah, absolutely. I think we'd have a great match with them.
Yeah.
I think it'd be entertaining, and I think we'd tear the house down. Whoever, whether it's me and Showtime or whether it's Showtime and A1, I think the chemistry is there, and I think... especially with the fans in Orlando, we're hated so much down there. And last week on Spike, we had a little smudge there at the end of the show where 3D came down to the ring and the fans just blew the roof off the place. So I think it'd be a lot of fun.
Yeah. Which crowd did you prefer? Did you prefer the Nashville one, or do you like the Orlando crowd?
I like them both. I'm so used to the Orlando crowd now. We've been there for over a year now, so it'd be nice to go back to Nashville just to see how it is. They're completely different crowds. The Nashville crowd is always they're really hard to describe. It's a real Southern, they want the Southern style, and they believe in a lot of the old school stuff, which is really cool. And the Orlando fans are pretty well educated. Some of the fans that we get down there are basically from the park that come in just to see the wrestling show and don't really know who any of us are. They've never watched the show. So, and that's kind of cool, too. So,
yeah,
I don't really have a preference.
You mentioned...
we'll say that, Barbie.
You mentioned Johnny Devine. Have you any idea when he's going to be slipping back into the mix?
Right now, we're not too sure. He's feeling much better. I know that he has to go back in for a small surgery... once again, but it's not really going to set him back any farther. Basically, it's just I don't really know the time frame. I don't believe he really knows the time frame. We're just kind of a wait and see process right now.
Yeah. What guys do you travel with on the road?
Right now, I always usually travel with Showtime and sometimes Simon Diamond and usually Wildcat Chris Harris. We're always usually. The three of us, Showtime and Wildcat and myself, are always usually in the car together, so we usually hang out together a lot. We're pretty close friends, these guys.
We always ask on here if anyone has any good road stories or rib stories. That's why I ask who you travel with. Or any ones you could tell on the air and won't get in trouble.
I better not. I better keep that to myself, yeah.
So that's how I'll be rude, Roll.
There's a lot of fun road stories to tell, but not enough time.
Right. Wait for the book.
Right.
Were you a wrestling fan growing up?
Yeah, I was. Being in Canada, of course, I mean, I was on hockey skates by the time I could walk. I grew up wanting to be a pro hockey player, and I played competitively all the way up to I was 19, playing Tier 2 Junior A in Canada, in Peterborough here where I live. But I really started to get in the niche. I started watching pro wrestling when I was like 7 or 8 years old, and I was always, I watched it every weekend, every time it was on, I was always in front of the TV, and there was a time I remember being, you know, getting close. I knew that I wasn't going to make it in pro hockey, and I knew that I wanted to do something, and I wanted to really try wrestling. And Val Venus was a good friend of mine, and I got in the ring with him when I was, I think, around 19, 20. And, you know, started learning the basics from him, and then he went off on the road, and Glenda boy Shane Sewell, who's a big star over in Puerto Rico and was Sean's, Val's partner at the time, he kind of took me under his wing, and he got me booked my first match in 98.
Who are some of the guys you you watch wrestle that you try to emulate in the ring?
Growing up, I mean, well, not necessarily growing up, I guess when I first got into the business when I was 19 and 20, I always studied and always watched tapes of Kurt Hennig. I always thought Kurt was one of the best in the business, and of course I always watched Flair, but now if there's a guy that I watch, I mean, I love watching Benoit, and I think Triple H is probably the best in the business, regardless of his position where he's at right now in that company, but I really do think that he's the best right now, and he's the guy that I admire.
Yeah. I don't know why, but you always remind me of Arn Anderson in the ring. Just the way
you know, I never actually got a chance to watch Arn, but when I was doing WWE stuff, Arn was always the guy that looked out for me and tried to help me as much as he could. And I've heard, the past couple of, since I've been with TNA, I've been compared to Arn and Kurt Hennig. So,
cool.
So, yeah.
Yeah, that's good guys to compare to, definitely.
Absolutely, yeah.
Got a question from the message board, Barbie?
Okay. Well, one of our biggest fans, Trey, wants to know if you feel that Team Canada should establish the individual identity you were talking about earlier, whether it should once again establish a tag team, Petey Williams in the X Division, and A1 as the muscle guy, and you as the world title run.
I think, you know, eventually it's going to get, like I said, it's going to get to that point, I think. It right now we're just trying to establish everyone, not just Team Canada itself as a group, but everybody, everybody's personalities, everybody on TV. I don't know if you watched Spike, but the debut show, but they had little clips of Three Live Crew explaining who exactly Three Live Crew is.
Right.
And we're just trying to educate the fans, but definitely down the road I think you're going to see a tag team. PD already is on his way to the X Division title again, I think.
Yeah.
And as far as heavyweight goes, I think that's going to be my position. I'm not too sure, but we'll just have to wait and see. But our characters are starting to kind of establish themselves little by little each week, so we'll see what happens.
Do you think that's something hard to do on TNA? Because you want to introduce the guys so everybody knows who they are, but you don't want to introduce everybody at once, or else people really don't remember who all the guys are.
Exactly.
So it's best to do like a few each week, maybe.
Yeah, I think that's the idea, actually. You know, there's of course some of the wrestling fans will know guys like Kevin Nash, and most people remember Jeff Hardy and Rhino. So there's really not a whole lot of explanation to do there. But new faces like AJ and you know Team Canada and Three Live Crew, guys like, you know, that aren't maybe as familiar to wrestling fans. I think it's probably important to educate them little by little.
Yeah. Another question from the message board?
Absolutely. Another one of our fans wants to know if, well, the basis of the question is TNA looking to impress Spike TV to perhaps increase impact to a two-hour show?
I think that's the idea. I mean, we have an opportunity right now to prove not only just to Spike, but really to the wrestling world as a whole that our show is real good, and I think that we're going to attract a lot of viewers down the road in the near future. So I hope that you know, that Spike believes in our product, and hopefully within the year or whenever, you know, possible, we can get that two-hour time slot, and hopefully it'll be on a Monday night when we can go, you know, head-to-head, hopefully down the road.
Yeah. That would be the time and the day you'd want it. If you could pick any day and any time, you'd want it 2 hours Monday night.
Yeah, oh, definitely. I think everybody would want that. I mean, everybody at TNA, the entire office, I mean, even I think Vince would want that eventually. I mean, just to see who actually, you know, to have that competition back like they had in the mid-90s.
Yeah.
And just to see if TNA is actually for real.
Another question there, Barb?
Raven Effect wants to know if you've got one experience in your career that stands out above all the others, be it a match or a promo or just being in the ring with somebody.
I've experienced so much really in TNA past year. Jesus, I mean, there's a whole list of stuff, I guess. I mean, one thing that kind of stands out in my mind is being in the ring with, and actually having a match with Dusty Rhodes, which was really cool.
Yeah.
Beat as it is, you know, that's something that I'll always remember. And, you know, we had all people always ask me all the time what my favorite match is to date, and there's no doubt that the tag match that Showtime and I had against AMW in January, it probably, I think it was Final Resolution, I think the pay-per-view was, and I thought it was probably one of the best matches on the pay-per-view, and it's a match that definitely stands out in my head.
Who's some of the guys that you've learned some from since you were in TNA? Anybody kind of take you under their wing?
You know, everybody is actually, you know, has accepted me with open arms. You know, all the veterans have, you know, they've always, you know, Shane Douglas has always, you know, since I got there, though, he's kind of taken me under his wing, so to speak. And Jerry Lynn, a lot of the agents have really taken care of me, Terry Taylor. As far as the boys go, BG James, Conan, and a lot of those guys have always been big fans and always have always tried to help with me, so... it's not just myself too. I mean, it's everybody. Our locker room is so good and so helpful. And you can really go to talk to anybody, and they're really helpful. Even the new guys that have come in, like Billy Gunn and guys like that. You go and ask them for advice, and they're willing to give it to you. And they're not, you know, they're not idiots about it. They're trying to help. And if you need help, they're there to help you. So it's a really good locker room.
Yeah. So it's definitely like a team community atmosphere.
Yeah, it definitely is.
Is there any more questions from the message board, Barbie?
Other guy wants to know, how does it feel working in an entertainment industry that usually tries to Americanize its talent, and yet you can get over the basis of the gimmick being that you're all Canadian?
I think it makes it a little easier, actually, to get the gimmick over, because we're not American, we're not same as everybody else, and we're outsiders, so to speak. So it's been easy. I mean, to be honest, it's not really, when we, you know, go down the ramp and get in the ring, I mean, it's not hard to generate heat from the crowd anywhere in the United States, so it's actually easy for us.
Right. You notice that a lot of the fans, you do get good heel heat, but at the same time, everybody seems to be wearing a Team Canada t-shirt. Does that...
Yeah.
Is that something that's shocked you or even the people backstage at TNA?
You know, there's always going to be the fans that, you know, love to hate you. And, or there's guys in the fans...
Like to cheer for the heels.
That want to be cool and cheer for the heels, right. And I think the whole... I mean, I love being a heel, and I don't want anybody clapping for me, believe me. Especially in the United States, the way to handle stuff like that is, you know, is to be a heel all the time. And whether there's people in the stands cheering for you or not, you just, I mean, I don't pay attention to any of that. But as far as the t-shirts and the signs and everything, you see that anywhere you go now in wrestling. Back in the old days, there was, you know, there was always cowboys and Indians and bad guys and good guys. But now it's so different, and the fans are so educated that a lot of the fans that buy the merchandise are well educated and just enjoy wrestling.
You can tell you're entertaining. It doesn't matter if you're supposed to be a bad guy or the good guy.
And still, a lot of the guys that there's a few people in Orlando that buy our t-shirts, and we still get booed, which is fun. But I think it has a lot to do with the fact that we're always in the same spot, always in the same building, always in front of the same people all the time. I think once TNA goes out on the road, it's going to be a different story.
I think our man, One-Inch Biceps, has a question he wants to ask you.
Oh, I was just wondering if you like steak.
Steak.
Steak. Oh, I love steak.
Do you ever eat anything with steak?
I'm trying to go for the A1 steak sauce line here.
No, I actually hate A1.
Oh man.
Bit of a clip in that one. Bobby Roode hates A1.
Oh man, interest in saving that line for all week.
The steak sauce.
Okay.
He just ruined his night.
Is there anything you'd like to say to your fans before we let you go in a minute here?
You know, just to keep supporting TNA, and you know, big things are going to happen in the next little while. We're just basically getting started, so we'll enjoy the ride, because all of us are certainly starting to enjoy it. So thanks for having me on the show, though. I really appreciate it.
Thanks a lot.
We appreciate you coming on.
Have you again sometime?
Absolutely.
Good luck in the future.
Yes, thank you very much.
This is Wildcat Chris Harris, part of America's Most Wanted and 1/2 of the NWA Tag Team Champions of the World, telling you to go to inyourheadonline.com. And if you don't like it, sorry about your damn luck.